Namaskar, welcome to Peak Guru's channel. I'm your host Sri Iyer, and today I have the pleasure of company of the editor of Financial Express, Sunil Jain. Sunil ji, namaskar and welcome to Peak Guru's channel.
Namaskar, lovely to be here, Sri.
So sorry to ruin your Sunday by, you know, calling you in for a chat, but I was really struck by the piece that you wrote about bureaucracy and the need for lateral entry into India's bureaucracy for the overall betterment. I can tell you some institutions that are crying for something like this. I'm sure you'll agree with me. SEBI is one, for example. See, the problem that SEBI has not been able to understand is the havoc co-location scam has done, and also the dark fiber. I can go on and on. Sunil, if I was not an electronics engineer who knew internet networking well, I would have not understood that. And you see, you need grounding in multiple disciplines to be able to understand and see what was the thing that was the mischief, right? So anyway, so this is one department that is crying out. There are many finance departments where I'm not so sure how well the modeling is being done. I'll give you an example. In EU, see, EU has a very funny system. They have a single monetary system among 20 plus countries, but each one has their own structure in terms of how much interest rates they want to. So their fiscal and their monetary systems are different, which is what causes all these problems for them. Yeah. I mean, Germany says that you shall remain within these bounds, but Greek didn't follow, Italy didn't follow. They haven't thrown out. So there is some, they have always just keep sliding it. And so this is becoming more and more of a problem. But what they do is they actually model for the entire EU. And economics today can be quantized. It's called econometrics. And the reason I'm saying all this is because I came across an article where somebody from EU, the minister, the EU finance group, had published a paper where they had said that they had relied extensively on a paper written by Dr. Subramanian Swamy for index numbers. See, so this paper came in the 70s, and they were using that, and they were quoting that this is how we have to do it, this is how we have to do it. Unfortunately, in India, we don't want to use his services. He's sitting right here, but we are trying to apply microeconomic concepts to a macroeconomic problem that is India. This is my opinion. Anyway, that is so there is crying need for so many places. So Sunil, do you know if there is a committee that has come up with a way to do these things, how to evaluate it? Is there a way the decisions of this kind of a person can be not challenged in Supreme Court? Or, I mean, that is the other problem, where anything that you do is a little bit out of the ordinary, it gets challenged. So I'm sorry to give you a long winding question, but basically what I'm asking you is, how real is this?
See, the thing is that, you know, the Prime Minister, for example, he has, you know, done a lot of lateral entry of bureaucrats. They've been brought in at a joint secretary level and, you know, sometimes lower than that. But, you know, I think so clearly, you know, as you pointed out, we need more professional bureaucrats. I mean, you know, we need professionals to come in and do some of the work that bureaucrats are doing. But, you know, so this takes us back to what the Prime Minister said, you know, in Parliament, when he said that, what is this obsession with, you know, having a bureaucrat to do everything, you know? He can't fly a plane, he's supposed to run a factory, he's supposed to do everything else. So the point that about my piece and the point that I was trying to make was that you certainly need much better quality bureaucrats. But this is a point which, you know, former education secretary, you know, he asked, Anil Swaroop asked, then how come if Mr. Modi is talking about the stranglehold of bureaucrats, even in places where you don't need bureaucrats, you know, you talked about SEBI, I'm talking about the Competition Commission or the IRDAI,
right.
You know, or you know, for example, the chairman of the Electricity Commission, the State Electricity Commission. These are jobs which should be run by professionals. So, you know, Mr. Modi himself is putting in bureaucrats where professionals were meant to be there. So I think there's a sort of disconnect there. The larger point that I want to make is that, again, while we need very good bureaucracy, you need an enlightened bureaucracy. The bureaucracy has a problem. You know, you talked about, for example, how in India, it has a limitation, not a problem. You know, you talked about how, for example, in India, everything goes to the Supreme Court eventually. Almost every decision of the government goes to the CAG, the CBI, and the CVC. So, you know, in a sense, like, you take the scan thing. So, for example, if the finance secretary or the revenue secretary is supposed to say, okay, we lost this case, let's give them the money. Now, you know, the CBI or the CAG can say, how did you give them $1.4 billion? You should have appealed in the Supreme Court. So, you know, then the CBI will be knocking at the poor finance secretary's door, you know, 20 years from now. So I can understand why the gentleman doesn't want to do it. But the point here is that, firstly, the cabinet should be taking some of these decisions. Secondly, the larger point here is that the government needs to de-license areas. You know, you need to decontrol completely. So, for example, you know, when I raised the issue about Dr. Manmohan Singh, that in 1991, if Dr. Manmohan Singh had called all his bureaucrats and said, let's be a little bit more liberal. You know, at that time, for example, the acrylic fiber plant in India had a 6,000 ton capacity. That was the maximum. I think the global averages in those days was about 1 lakh tons. So we were completely, you know, our scale was so awful. This is why we were so expensive. So Dr. Manmohan Singh didn't tell his bureaucrats, instead of doing 6,000, usko 12 kar do, 18 kar do. You know, he just said, de-licensed. I'm not going to exercise any control on this. So what Mr. Modi needs to do, if he genuinely wants to free up the economy from what he calls the bureaucratic chokehold, he needs to just say that there will be no controls on this. You know, the problem is that the government of India wants to retain control on everything and yet tell the bureaucrats that you need to be a bit more liberal. That doesn't work. So, for example, you take the Essential Commodities Act. Now, it's been a problem, you know, for decades people have been talking about how the Essential Commodities Act is a problem. Because the government can raid people anytime, people don't want to set up storage facilities, then there's a huge problem associated with it. Now, what Mr. Modi has done is, he has retained the Essential Commodities Act, but he's increased the trigger for using it has become a bit more stringent. That doesn't work. The government is interested, there will be no Essential Commodities Act. Let's say for the sake of argument that suddenly for some reason, wheat prices in India go up by 200% because of, you know, there's a crop shortage, there's a global crop shortage, everything. You know, Food Corporation of India is sitting on supply there. So you can just dump them in the market to lower the prices. Let's say the prices of onions rise by 500%, and you know, firstly, I don't think it's going to make a big dent in everybody's life, but assuming it does, the government of India can just start giving people cash transfers at that point, you know, the poor people, cash transfers to take care of it. The problem is that while Mr. Modi is saying that we need to de-bureaucratize, so to speak, in order to do that effectively, you don't need a new bureaucracy. What you need to do is you need to say that the bureaucracy is not going to come in certain areas. In other areas, to get back to Cairn, you know, de-bureaucratization takes a long time. It's not a simple thing. But so I want to go back to Cairn on this case. Now, so what Mr. Modi needed to do was, okay, so the finance secretary takes the view that he takes because he's a bureaucrat, and he said that I will be hauled up before the CAG, the CBI, the CAG, and perhaps the Supreme Court also, somebody will file a PIL or something. Why can't the cabinet of Mr. Modi take a decision saying that, you know, we think that that not honoring this commitment is bad for India's image. This is a promise we made. And by the way, as it happens, this retrospective tax is a Congress legacy. So this is something he can genuinely blame on the Congress. He right. can say, Dr. Manmohan Singh, the great economist Dr. Manmohan Singh, left me with this mess. So, you know, I don't like to pay this $1.4 billion, but actually this has to be debited against the Congress government's account. So, you know, in certain areas, you know, because you're never going to be able to fix something completely. You will have problems. That is where the cabinet comes in. The cabinet can come in and sit down and say, we've taken a decision that that we're going to change the law. To get to a very simple example of this is, in 1999, telecom privatization, as you know, in India began in 1991. By about 96, 97, these companies had run into serious problems. And, you know, the government wasn't doing anything. That's when Mr. Vajpayee came in. And he realized that you needed to move to a different, you know, licensing network. So instead of these people giving a fixed lump sum license fee, regardless of whether they were doing well or badly, they needed to move to a revenue share. So what did Mr. Vajpayee do? He didn't say that let the bureaucrats come up with a solution. No matter how good a bureaucrat is, the bureaucrat would have been in trouble. He would have been hauled up by somebody or the other. Mr. Vajpayee's cabinet sat down, took a decision. I mean, luckily for us, there was no serious flak. But if there was serious flak, it would have been taken by the cabinet, not by the bureaucrat. So I think, you know, while like you, like everyone, like I have my own stories of horrors of the bureaucracy. Everybody has them here. You know, especially the taxman here. But there is a role for the Prime Minister's cabinet. Why don't these people come and do their job and just make it easier? That was the short point that I wanted to make.
Thanks for that, Sunil. But so bureaucracy is, does India need the kind of size that it has now for the bureaucracy. What is your honest opinion?
See, you don't need the size of the bureaucracy that you have in its totality. But, you know, we've got this head-to-tail ratio problem. So you've got a very, very small number of IS officers. You've got a very large number of peons. So we need to fix that. You know, bureaucracy would include, teachers and health workers and stuff like that. India is woefully short out there. So I don't think there is a simple answer to whether India needs as many bureaucrats or government officials, so to speak. So, in some areas you need them, in some areas we don't. But the point is that we need to bring in specialists where specialists are needed. You talked about SEBI. You know, when I look at, the American equivalent of SEBI, you just look at the number of lawyers and economists and all on their staff, and you look at the American equivalent of the Competition Commission. They're very, very hugely staffed compared to what we have. Yeah. So certainly in certain kind of areas and posts, we need to really strengthen our bureaucracy. So for example, we have an FRBM. So I think we actually need an Office of Budget Management, which is actually looking at the long-term implications of a policy taken right now, long-term issues of debt and things like that. So in certain areas, we certainly need to increase our staff size a lot. In certain areas, we can do away with them. And, I don't think there can be any doubt that we need a lot more expertise. But you're not going to get the expertise unless the Prime Minister wants it to happen. That's the unfortunate part, or the fortunate part, depending on how you want to look at it.
Now, I want to take you to a slightly different topic, which is actually the raging debate right now. Because just like in cricket, the number 100 has a very special effect. And now, the price of 1 liter of petrol has crossed 100 rupees in many states. The center is getting the blame for it. However, I want to look at it in a more scientific manner. 2017, we had the GST passed. However, two things were excluded from it: liquor and petroleum and all the related products. Was that a temporary measure that would be normalized very soon, or was it something that was never going to be normalized? Because today, the states where the BJP is not in power can easily take a bigger hike and then blame it on the center. And that's what it looks like is happening.
Well, I think, even in the states where the BJP is in power, the excise duties are quite high. I think the reason why petroleum products were kept out of GST was that neither the center nor the states wanted to give up a cash cow. We can blame the states, but I don't think the central government wanted to, to keep the excise duty low on petrol and diesel either. Yeah. So I think, both sides are to blame for this. There is no doubt about it. Right now, I haven't looked at the numbers immediately, but right now the states have a bigger problem, or they should actually share a bigger part of the blame. Because what is happening is that the central government, their excise duty is a specific rate. So, whether the price of oil is $20 or $40 or $100, the government is going to take the same X rupees per liter of petrol. In the state government, it's ad valorem. So when the price moves from 20 to 40 to 60 to 80, the state taxes go up a lot more. So I think, both sides have a problem. The central government did well to, actually move to a specific rate. But I think there is a larger case, even in the case of the central government. Frankly, when prices are reaching 100 rupees a liter, the central government should have just said, listen, I will take this specific rate till oil prices reach X amount. When they reach X amount, I'm going to lower my rate, so that the consumer doesn't bear such a big burden, especially this is COVID time. So after post-COVID, the government wants to stimulate private demand. I mean, the reason is because there's no private demand, the government is stepping up its own expenditure. But its main thing is to step up private demand. You can't be expecting people to fork out 100 rupees a litre for petrol and then expect private demand to go up. So I think, one, the centre needs to be reducing its rate. Secondly, you talked about BJP versus non-BJP states. Maybe the BJP states could say, okay, we're going to reduce our rate. If, for example, Haryana reduces its rate, it puts pressure on Captain Amrinder Singh in Punjab that how come you're not reducing your rate? So I think the government needs to be a little proactive on these things, whether it is on the issue of Cairn or whether it's the issue of petrol prices that you're talking about. Government need to realize that, hey, we've got an issue and we need to be proactive, we need to tackle this. I think one of the problems, in fact, we saw this in the case of the farm laws also, keep in mind that long before the farmers came to Delhi, they were agitating in Punjab. Yeah. So I think the government, the central government, you know, I don't know whether it negotiated hard enough or tried to negotiate when these people were in Punjab. But certainly the messaging, you know, if you look at, for example, everybody, you, me, everybody seems to be very impressed with the way the Prime Minister tackled the issue in Parliament. But, you know, the Prime Minister is coming in the 45th over of a 50-over match. The point is that, you know, what were people doing in the first few overs? So I think that the government needs to be a bit more proactive. Hopefully, you know, we are seeing signs of this, you know, the hesitation going away. I don't know whether that's permanent or whether it's, you know, just a temporary thing, but we have to hope that the government is more proactive.
Sunil, last question before we wind up the show. Why did the government not think of having future contracts? And see, if today it is going up, that means that India is buying its crude from the spot market and not having any guaranteed contracts. When last year in March 2020, the contracts actually went negative, meaning people were having so much quantities, they wanted anyone and everyone to offload it into so that they could have some flow of money. I mean, that is the time for a country like India, which has a huge requirement, which doesn't produce much of its own, to jump in and have long-term 3-5 year contracts with the oil producers. So if they had done that, today India would be, you know, sitting on an even larger chest of foreign exchange. Why did this not happen? There are so many Babus. Don't they know this?
I think, you know, this is where the issue of specialists comes in. That, you know, the thing is that if there was, let's say, a dedicated team whose only job was to scour around the world to look for great, you know, contracts for oil and look at, you know, is the futures market going to be, should we be in the futures market? How much should we be in the futures market? These are sort of decisions which professionals should be taking. So if you had a specialized body who would not be, you know, one, they could do that. Secondly, I think here again, which is where this whole CBI and all these people come in, and even the press, and maybe, you know, so let's say for the sake of argument that you've got oil price at $30. Yeah. Now, you know, given the way oil prices are rising, you and I will say that, you know, they should have locked in a lot more than they, you know, than they did. But the, let's say the oil price comes down to 20. Yeah. Then, you know, immediately the newspapers, the CAG, CBI, the Congress party are going to say, oh, this is Modi's way of giving $10 extra to the sheikhs in Saudi Arabia. So I think, you know, we've made everything so political in India now that, you know, we have a problem there. But as I said, you know, if, like, you know, just to talk about oil now, one of my favorite things is, one of the reasons why PSUs are not allowed to be free in India, under the constitution, they are considered to be an arm of the state, what is called instrumentalities of state. So if Mr. Modi was to change this part of the constitution and say, as long as a PSU is working in a competitive environment, so like let's say IOC is competing with Reliance, which it is, IOC will not be considered to be an instrumentality of state. So that's, you know, that would free up IOC. But here's the good part. Now when IOC is going to be buying oil in the future, IOC then sets up a body of experts who then say, okay, you know, I think we should lock in 20% of our requirements at $50, another 15% at 60, 30% at 25, you know, they would set up parameters like that. Once IOC is not an instrumentality of state, I don't think people can question IOC that why did you do this contract? You know, I'm sure Reliance, for example, when it's buying its oil, it's got all these things worked out. You know, Reliance has one of the lowest, you know, purchase prices for oil because they have experts doing this all the time and they don't have somebody other than Mukesh Ambani. They don't have somebody questioning whether they took the right decision or not. So, you know, that is what this whole, so when if India wants genuine reform, this is what we need to do. Well, you know, with this thing that we want to control everything, I want to check the price of oil or, you know, that, okay, why did you buy 20? Why didn't you buy 22? You know, we are running some of these decisions, I'm sorry to say this, some of these decisions are being taken the way you and I would run our household. You know, you will tell your son that did you really need to go to that shop to buy the bread because the one next to it is offering a 25% discount. I don't know what you're doing. You know, so you can't run, you can't run government, you can't run even reasonably sized companies on that basis, you know. So we just need to free up a lot more.
Yeah, I know this, and I'm sure you agree with me on this. Somebody is making money hand over fist right now because of this pricing at the market. And you just hinted who it is. Is making a huge payback here. If that person had smartly tied up the lower future rates. Anyway, thank you very much, Sunil. And we'll be back. We'll discuss a little bit more. I want to talk about liquor also maybe next time, because liquor also is not under GST. And maybe it's the same reason why it was left out as petrol, that both sides wanted to make some money off of that.
Yeah.
And we have a nation of drunks. So... Because if you look at it, the first things that formed when the lockdown was lifted was the line to the liquor shops.
Yeah, exactly.
So, any rate, it was wonderful talking to you. I'll let you go back and enjoy the rest of your weekend. And thank you so much once again. And we'll be back more such interesting hangouts. I'm sorry, if you want to say something in the end, please go ahead.
No, I just wanted to thank you. Lovely to be here with you. And I get a great response from all your hangouts. So I just love being here.
Yeah, thank you so much. Thank you. It's my pleasure. You are a subject matter expert, and it always tickles my bones, because I need to get challenged too once in a while. I need to go back and brush up on all these financial matters. That's actually not my subject. It's not my bailiwick. But I feel good to participate. Some dumb questions come. That's okay. It's like a Sherlock Holmes versus Dr. Watson kind of a conversation.
I'm a journalist. So I don't have answers anyway. The answers I've got are borrowed from somebody else.
Wonderful. So thank you so much, and have a great day.
Thank you. Have a great day. Bye-bye.